Louisville, UConn, and Pitt.
You take a look at the first half stats. Miami, Ohio, the big one, 1 of 8 from beyond the arc, came into this game 5th in the nation in three-point shooting at over 50%. And you look at the points off turnovers. West Virginia with more points off turnovers than Miami, Ohio has points.
And Steve, I think you told me this, that Miami, Ohio shoots better from three-point range than they do from two. But so far this game, they are 1 of 8 from three-point range.
Yeah, very odd in college basketball to find a team that shoots better from three than they do from two. We asked Coach Coles about that as Butler gets the scoring going in the first half, picks up right where he left off. 9 points in the game for him.
Good catch and shoot off a flex cut kind of pass. But you got to think, everybody talked about at the beginning of the year, yeah, this three-point line is going to make such a difference. And see another turnover right there. But I think these kids love it. They're shooting from deep anyway. They don't care.
Butler looking for Wellington Smith underneath the bucket. Mentioned Butler with 9. He actually has 12. Ruoff with 12. And we'll check that, Butler with 10. Truck Bryant, the freshman, with 9. And the big one for Miami, Ohio, Michael Bramos, only with 5 points in the first half. Came into this game averaging 20 to lead the Red Hawks. Durker's underneath, another block from behind by Ruoff. In transition, Flowers wide open for three, can't get it to go.
Well, when you saw 2 plays ago, Chuck Bryant create that turnover, I can't tell you how imperative that's gonna be for this West Virginia team going into the Big East play. His point guard skills, you see another turnover right there. This is something that he really needs to work on. He's a very talented player. But when you go against the likes of a Louisville, a UConn, a Pitt, a Notre Dame, I mean, he's got to go against Torrey Jackson, some guys who, advanced field, some guys who are not only going to attack him offensively, but defensively, he's going to have to hold his own. And offensively, he's going to have to run his team. So he's a huge part to what they're trying to create here at West Virginia.
Timeout, West Virginia. We'll take a break. 49-17 Mountaineers. Just about a minute. 47 remaining in the second half. All Mountaineers 49-17. And head coach for West Virginia, Bob Huggins. You see the numbers of active wins among coaches in Division I basketball right now. Bob Huggins, 4th on that list with 623. Last year, his first year at West Virginia's alma mater, took the Mountaineers to the Sweet 16, the best first year for any head coach in program history.
Well, I think he did a great job of really coming in and changing the style of this West Virginia team, you know, from a John Beilein system to a Bobby Huggins system, which is kind of in your face, the nitty gritty style of play.
Paulitz gets it to go, 4 points on the game for him. Underneath the bucket, it's Flowers, blocked from behind, but a foul. It's going to go against Fletcher.
And I got to admit, Bobby Huggins got a chance to coach me around 2000. I love his style. I love the kind of, you know, intensity that he always plays with. And this guy has the ability to recruit. Talk about what he did at Cincinnati, bringing in Danny Fortson, Kenyon Martin, Steve Logan, Kenny Satterfield. Then going over to Kansas State, what he's done, getting Michael Beasley, Billy Walker. I mean, and he's doing the same thing here, guys. I mean, they're talking about bringing some very talented freshmen next year. Dalton Pepper, Denise Kilichi, Danny Jennings. I mean, all these guys, especially the guy from Turkey, 6'9", 264 power forward, is probably one of the most athletic players Bobby Huggins said he'll ever get a chance to coach. Even more so to Jason Maxill or Kenyon Martin.
Durker's underneath, foul on the floor. And you mentioned the recruiting, Jay, and a big part of that Bob Huggins will attribute is to his assistant coach Larry Harrison, and calls him a key recruiter and says, you know, he just has contacts in areas that our current staff didn't have when he first got here with West Virginia, and has 2 number 1 recruiting classes under his belt with DePaul in 1998 and back in Cincinnati in 1996 when he was with Bob Huggins.
Michael Beasley wasn't too bad, huh?
Not too bad either, yeah. Richburg into the game. He's the starting point guard. Kenny Hayes, usually the starter. Bramos knocks it down inside the 3-point line. 2 for him.
The only reason Bramos made that shot is because Flowers became a little lackluster on defense. He, instead of staying down his stance, he raised up, which allowed Bramos to get a backdoor cut. And that's something that Bobby Huggins really stresses. He wants his players to be in a top physical condition. Even in practice, when they mess up, guys, in practice, when they mess up. So he puts them on a treadmill for 44 seconds and makes them run at 15 miles an hour. So there's no soft cuts here. You're not gonna cheat any of my drills. You're gonna run hard every single play.
Too strong by Smith. Miami, Ohio, trying to get some kind of run started here in the second half, down 50-21. Bramos again in the low post with the left hand, can't get it. Fletcher though, offensive rebound. Bramos comes up with an offensive foul.
Smart move by Butler right there to keep his hands up and just hold.
College basketball and holiday hoops presented by K Jewelers on ESPNU today. For more information, log on to ESPNU.com.
Steve, I got to ask you this question. I know everybody talked about it at the beginning of the year, but do you think UNC has a chance to run the table?
I think Duke's going to have something to say about that, Jay. Short by Ruoff, but again, Butler on the offensive end. 14 points for him. The big game that you got to circle is at Duke.
Not only that game, I think Clemson's playing exceptional basketball. Casey Rivers, Trevor Booker, also Wake Forest. I mean, Jeff Teague had a great game last night against the Richmond Spiders. 28 points, made six shots in a row. Just a great player. And Al-Farouq Aminu is a star in the rising. I mean, this kid is 6'8", has a 41-inch vertical. And Dino Guadio is so excited to get some of those guys down there playing great basketball.
Jeff Teague, the leading scorer in the ACC right now. And not exactly as top heavy as it was last year. Truck Bryant all the way to the hole. The freshman with 11.
And that's where Truck Bryant can be very dangerous. You know, you see a lot of freshmen when they come in, they play 100 miles an hour. He's figuring out. He just made a move at 50 and then he went up to 75.
30-second timeout called by head coach Charlie Coles, and can't be happy with that easy layup that the Red Hawks gave up to Truck Bryant on that last possession. Head coach Charlie Coles, an incredible story for the Red Hawks, and you just take a look at this, the story behind this guy. He's 66 years old. Last March went through a roller coaster of the season, took himself to the hospital in late March, and 10 days later had to have bypass surgery. And this is after, in 1998, almost passed away of cardiac arrest. And what makes the story so great is that a year after he went into cardiac arrest in 1998, best year in Miami, Ohio history, came back to coach for them, went to the Sweet 16, the only Sweet 16 in program history, led by their first team All-MAC performer, Wally Cerbiak.
Well, what a great guy. And yesterday, got a chance that both you and I to talk to him. And I just told him from the sincere place in my heart that I really appreciated what he did, because, you know, these kids, you know, they need advocates in their life, not just from a coaching perspective, but from a mentor perspective. You know, it's not just about the game of basketball, but more importantly, it's about the game of life. And that's what Coach Coles is great at teaching at.
Durkers gets called for the travel. We'll take a break. 54-21. Talk a little bit more about the 33-point lead for the Mountaineers. 15-43 remaining in the game here in Morgantown. And touched on it before, head coach for Miami, Ohio, Charlie Coles, and the incredible story of him. And we talked about, you know, all he's gone through with his heart condition, Jay. And we just got a chance to talk to him at shoot-around yesterday here in the building. And just a shot of life from a guy who's gone through so much.
He was, and you know, for his players, I don't care what they say, nothing could be too big. I mean, this guy has been on his deathbed a couple of times, and he comes back, and he always finds a way to be energized and be supportive. I don't care if the players have a bad day at class or if their puppy passes away. I mean, they have nothing to mourn about.
Intercepted in the lane by Durkers. Richburg comes back the other way, takes it himself, and gets it to go. Nice drive by Richburg in the lane. And we asked Coach Cole, you know, you've gone through so much. You've had two bypass surgeries. You have a defibrillator right now. You went through surgery last year where they had to reshape your heart. What makes you keep coming back? And he said, you know, pretty much he just has an addiction to it. You know, those were his words. And, you know, if it's still fun, why not keep coming back?
I think it's the love for the game. I think it's seeing these kids grow and develop over their time. And like we said, I think the big thing for Coach Coles is just not letting these kids be successful at the game of basketball, but more importantly, be successful at the game of life.
Into the lane as Durkers finds Fletcher underneath, and foul on the floor. Going to get Wellington Smith for the call.
Well, Miami, their offense has been struggling. They have 40 possessions so far and 19 turnovers. It's almost a possession. I mean, for every two possessions, that's one turnover. So not doing a good job of taking care of the ball. And I think that's where they're missing Kenny Hayes from that leadership perspective, running the team, running the sets, making sure everybody gets at the right place at the right time.
Wellington Smith picks up his fourth foul. That's going to force him to go to the bench. Back into the game, freshman Kevin Jones. And stolen by Alex Ruoff, but he stepped on the sideline. Red Hawks will get the ball back.
I think this is a great chance to see the mentality of West Virginia basketball. You talk about they're up 31 points in this game. Will they have the ability to really put their foot down and close this win out? Or will they allow Miami to hang around and just linger and maybe get a chance to not only get back in the ball game all the way, but make the game look respectable?
Three from outside by Nick Winbush falls, the 6'7 sophomore, his first points of the game. But we were curious, Jay, to see how West Virginia would come out considering that they've had 7 days off for finals. Butler puts up a 3.25 to answer, can't get it. Rebounded by Butler. Fletcher with the rebound, excuse me. Richburg very quickly the other way. Winbush again for three. Got it.
Well, this is what we're talking about, the ability to put their foot down and finish the game, which they'll need to do in Big East play. Any team can come out in the first half and dominate a performance, but the ability to keep that domination continue throughout the entire game shows you the mentality of a team.
Red Hawks trying to get back into this game on an 8-0 run. And Winbush a little bit too aggressive on the defensive end.
And look at it. Look how the energy's Miami picked up for Miami, right? You saw them in the first half. They kind of came out. It was like, la, 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 la. And now they're down by almost 30 points. They don't want to get embarrassed. Now they're starting to fight. They're starting to play with their intensity. They came out in the first half and played the same way. They might have been in this ballgame.
Now, how much is WVU letting up as well a little bit, maybe being a little content to have that 33-point lead a moment or two ago?
Well, they haven't been making shots so far in the second half. And Bobby Huggins wants them to continue. It shows a lot about the maturity, you know, especially for Darryl Bryant being a freshman. Sometimes you can become a little content, you know, when you make a couple of jump shots, you're up by 30 points. But for somebody who's came back from 10 points in a couple of situations, a couple of times, anything can happen. This is college basketball. That's what makes it great.
Bramos, the sharpshooting senior, doing everything he can to get the ball, and Ruoff won't give it to him on the outside, forcing him to go up and gets that one to fall. The crazy fall away from Bramos falls, and Ruoff picks up the foul, and it'll be a three-point opportunity from Bramos. That was pretty.
Well, I like the patience, but look, Mr. Winbush comes in the game, knocks down some jump shots. Then Mr. Bramos like, I can show you I can do it too. You're not going to be the only person to carry my team on my back. Great concentration.
Finally
right
seeing
here.
Some energy from the Miami, Ohio players. And Michael Bramos started this game 2 for 8, and he's knocked down his last two shots. 10 points on the game for him now.
And it amazes me about shooters. The one thing I learned in college as a shooter is that you always come out and you attack the basket. That's always the first thing you do. You get yourself going. When you attack the basket, all of a sudden it allows your jump shot to come very easy. And now you see Bramos attacking the basket, making heads up play. They're playing with a lot of energy and passion. Different Miami team first half compared to second half.
A little bit too aggressive from Truck Bryant. You see Bramos on the defensive end, draws the charge. Let's take another look at this one, Jay. It looks like his feet might not have been set on this.
Well, it was. I don't think it was the fact that his feet were set. It's the fact that Bryant extended his forearm, which you can't do. And so far in the last 5 possessions for West Virginia, they've had 3 turnovers. Need to do a better job of taking care of the ball.
Winbush again, offensive foul.
Those are always one of the calls that really frustrated me as a player. When a guy is standing underneath the basket and you're already up in the air, you're going to the basket, you come down, you charge. But still, great awareness by Ruoff to understand the rules of the game. And it really holds strong to take this charge.
You see the halo underneath the basket in the NBA saying that if even if you are set defensively, you can't draw a charge within, say, 3 feet or so underneath the basket. They experimented with that in college basketball, and we haven't seen much of it after that. Is that something that you think they should integrate into the game?
I think it's something to definitely keep on mind. A lot of guys, when they drive, already leave their feet, and guys slide underneath the basket, and they're considered to have placement. But I still see it as one that should stay, and I think they should try new rules out. We got a new 3-point line. Why not give that a shot?
Kevin Jones knocks down the mid-range jumper. 8 points for the freshman.
He's been very impressive so far, 6'8", shooting the basketball, driving to the basket.
Tough pass by Tyler Durkers, picked off by Bryant, back the other way. Cross midcourt, pulls up at the free throw line off the front of the rim, and Richburg comes up with it.
In that situation, I'd love to see Bryant give the ball up. He had a couple guys trailing him. Give it up and get it back.
Pull up 3 way short, rebounded by Thurman, who's into the game. 56-32, West Virginia. 11:30 to play. Ruoff wants the ball top of the key, left open, and knocks it down with Winbush in his face. And another timeout on the floor. Miami, Ohio only has one left in this game. And just left wide open out on the perimeter was Ruoff.
Boy, it was. Nobody recovered, and Wimbush got a hand out there too late. But one of the things that surprises me about this West Virginia team is, you know, you talk about Miami made a couple of runs. Wimbush hit a couple of jump shots. Ramos knocked down a jump shot to kind of get them emotionally back in the game. But I don't know if I really see the energy that I usually see from Bobby Huggins' teams. When I got a chance to watch Cincinnati play back in the day, I mean, those were guys who were fierce competitors. I mean, every possession, they were clawing, they were fighting in your face. They had that intensity. And after Ruoff just made that shot, it's kind of like everybody's came back like, oh, okay, you know, we're still up almost 25, 30. But they had to find that killer instinct, and that's what they're going to need to have, especially going to Big East play.
This is a team that was picked to finish ninth in the preseason coaches poll in the Big East. And most years you say, eh, it's not very good. This year in the Big East, ninth might just get you into the NCAA tournament. And you look at the schedule earlier this year, two losses on neutral courts, first to Kentucky in Las Vegas and also to Davidson. In that Davidson game, they did a very good job of containing Stephen Curry until he went off with about 3 minutes left in that game. Ramos for three, too long, misses everything.
But just like we spoke about, Steve, that's a test for this team. Woo! See that in our move?
Look at that.
A little shake and bake right there.
I'm the freshman.
Shake and bake. A little Brooklyn style back for you. But that is the key for this West Virginia team, the ability to maintain and to finish games through. You have to be able to close games down. And due to their lack of experience with some freshmen in key roles, that's something they're going to have to work on throughout the season.
Fletcher blocked away, two on none the other way. Butler throws it down. Little chest pump for the crowd. 63-32, 10-15 to play here in the Coliseum. Richburg trying to create. Durkers now off balance shot from the free throw line, gets it to fall.
Great poise by Durkers right there to gather himself, catch the ball, turn around and face to the bucket. Get a nice easy deuce.
To West Virginia's defense, that loss to Davidson in the Jimmy V Classic at Madison Square Garden, they didn't shoot very well from the free throw line. That's a problem. Nice spin move by Ruoff. Can't get it to go, but a foul underneath. We'll see if they'll call it on Ruoff or not. We'll see who the foul is on when we come back. But crossover from Truck Bryant back the other way and a pretty move. And it's been all West Virginia in the second half. Butler. Welcome back inside the WV Coliseum here in Morgantown, West Virginia. 63-34, the Mountaineers over the Red Hawks. Steve Andress alongside former Duke great and National Player of the Year. Second overall pick by the Chicago Bulls. The list goes on and on for our own Jay
Thank
Williams.
You. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Jay, so far in this game, it's been pretty much all West Virginia, but a big part of that has been the play of their freshman and highly touted freshman at that.
Well, they have a lot, you know, you talk about Daryl Bryant, a kid who's having a phenomenal game, you know, from Brooklyn. Just his poise at the point guard spot is key for this team, but it's been their defense that's been doing it. You talk about they really forced 22 turnovers and have 22 points off the turnovers. And so far, you know, Miami only has 7 assists. So, you know, and this is the loss of Kenny Hayes we were talking about. They really don't have that person, that go-to guy that can create for everybody on the floor.
Kenny Hayes out with the wrist injury, played 20 minutes last game. A 5-second violation on Kramer Soderberg, couldn't get rid of the ball. Kenny Hayes out with that wrist injury, missed 2 games ago against Wisconsin-Milwaukee, gave it a go against Valparaiso, played 20 minutes, but only took 2 shots, and it was really evident and might need surgery as well later on. But for West Virginia, Truck Bryant, a kid out of St. Raymond's High School. He's from Brooklyn, New York, played at St. Raymond's in the Bronx. Same school as Allen Ray, the former Villanova great, who scored almost over 2,000 points for the Wildcats. There's Bryant right on cue for 3. Showed up today in maybe a statement game for Truck Bryant with Joe Mazzulla out of the lineup, the usual starting point guard for the Mountaineers.
Well, the key for this team's evolution throughout their time that Truck Bryant will be here will be how he handles the point guard responsibilities. I don't care what anybody says, when you come out of high school, you're used to scoring, you know, all-time leading scorer for St. Raymond's, but now he not only has to be a scorer, but he has to get other people involved. He has to understand shot clock, shot time situation, be an extension from his coach, and be the defensive spearhead for a good West Virginia team.
Butler knocks down the three, 17 points on the game for him. And Jay, how hard is that for a freshman who's used to scoring, the all-time leading scorer at his high school, to now have to come in and take over for a guy in Darius Nichols who had a 3-to-1 assist-to-turnover ratio?
Well, I think it's very difficult. And not only he doesn't have to worry about his scoring as much as I feel like sometimes in the game he does, I think it's more about getting people involved, getting Deshaun Butler off, getting Alex Rue off. If he gets these guys going, it's going to be easier for him to attack the basket and score points himself.
Julia Mavunga goes up, draws the foul. Two free throws for him when we return. West Virginia playing well in their first game since finals week, 7 days off, but they're not showing it here in the Coliseum. College basketball here on ESPNU. Holiday Hoops presented by K Jewelers. And West Virginia picked ninth in the preseason Big East poll by the coaches. And Jay, we mentioned it before, that's usually not very good, but in this year's Big East Conference, that's pretty good.
Well, for West Virginia's sake, I mean, they are always predicted in the top 10 in the Big East preseason poll, but over the last 6 years, they finished higher than what their preseason predictions have said. So that's something good taking into this. But you got to look at UConn. I mean, they're a powerhouse. They seem to be the comeback of Stanley Robinson now and A.J. Price, and they have a star in Kemba Walker. And, you know, Louisville, Rick Pitino really has this guy going, even though they lost to Western Kentucky. Samardo Samuels has a chance to be one of the best big men to play at Louisville. And with Earl Clark playing an NBA-style game, and also Terrence Williams in the wing and Edgar Sosa, I mean, they have a very, very good team. And, you know, let's not count Notre Dame or Pitt. I think Pitt, hands down, is one of the best teams in the Big East, one of the best teams in the country. But it's going to be a battle. Every game is going to be a battle in this league. And I'm sure that West Virginia is going to be able to catch a lot of teams on sleepy nights. I mean, you talk about you play Louisville, Connecticut, Notre Dame, back to back to back, and all of a sudden you're coming in here to play West Virginia, you're going to have a little letdown. It's like, oh, we're playing against West Virginia. And then all of a sudden they come in and they shock you with the athleticism of some of their players.
Julian Mavunga goes one of two from the line into the game for West Virginia is Will Thomas, the backup point guard from today, usually the third string point guard, four to shoot on the shot clock, gets it to Jones in the corner, misses everything, and that's a shot clock violation. Did not hit the rim. Caught the backboard, but that's not good enough to reset the shot clock. You mentioned the Big East schedule, Jay, and if West Virginia, remember now, in the Big East, all 16 teams make the Big East tournament this year. So if they do finish where they're picked, ninth, that means they would have to play an extra game in the first round. The 9 seed would play the 16 seed on Tuesday, and the top 8 seeds would get byes starting and would not have to play until Wednesday. 5 through 8 byes on Wednesday. 1 through 4 would not have to play until Thursday. Blocked away out of bounds. Kevin Jones.
Well, let's not forget that this is a team that went to the semifinals last year of the Big East tournament. You see the athleticism, and this is where I think they're going to surprise a lot of teams. You talk about their starting lineup, even though Chuck Bryant's 6'1", they have him listed as 6'2", but 6'1", then they go 6'7", 6'8", 6'7", 6'5". And so they have the length and the athleticism to really hang with those teams. Now, the main question that I have for this team is their point guard play. You know, will Darryl Chuck Bryant be poised enough to handle the pressures of guys like Torrey Jackson, the Mansfields, Edgar Sosa? Will he be able to, you know, handle those kind of environments as a freshman right away? It's a lot to ask for a young kid.
First free throw good from Fletcher. He has 7 points on the game, well above his average of 1.8. Came into this game only shooting 23% on the year. Second free throw good as well. That ties a career high for Fletcher with 8 points.
Well, you hope that Miami could take some lessons out of today's game about rebounding and about attacking the basket, taking that back to the Mid-American Conference. You know, you have preseason Akron's listed number one, and you know, Ohio University Bobcats are two. Kent State has a great player and played one of the players of the year candidates, Al Fisher.
So then at 4 o'clock Eastern, Iowa takes on Drake. College basketball and Holiday Hoops presented by K Jewelers on ESPNU.
And I'm going to say something. It's probably going to cause a little controversy, but I'm going to say it anyway.
All right.
I think when you talk about player of the year, you know, everybody talks about Tyler Hansbrough, Blake Griffin right away. I think you got to find some way to put the point guard for UNC, Ty Lawson, in that category. He's having a great year, and you see the way, like, without Tyler Hansbrough, they're still winning games. If you take Ty Lawson away from that team, I don't think they're anywhere close to the team that they could be.
Seems like other than Stephen Curry, the player of the year talks this year are going to the big men in Hansbrough and Griffin. Hook shot no good from Mavunga. Those last two free throws from West Virginia made by D. Prody. No look past the Prody. Gets it to go. Great look from Alex Ruoff, his sixth assist of the game.
Well, Prody, a junior college transfer from Angelina College in Round Rock, Texas. With his frame, 6'10", 240, his ability to run the floor, Bobby Huggins thinks he could be an integral part in what they need to do in years to come.
See what he can do on the offensive end again, the recipient of that great backdoor pass. And Butler says, no, he's looking for a pass, but I'm just going to spot up for three and knocks it down. 20 points for Butler, four away from his season and career high that he scored against Davidson in Madison Square Garden a couple weeks ago.
Well, he's such a humble kid. I got a chance to work out with him at Chicago and Tim Grover. And he can do it all. He can put the ball on the ground. He can shoot the basketball. I think he has a chance to be a pro. He's just finding that killer instinct and keeping that button turned on the entire game.
Nice drive by Bramos, 12 in the game for him. But again, from inside the arc where he's less dangerous to this Mountaineers team. Will Thomas, mid-range jumper, no good. Picked up by Bramos, and here comes Miami, Ohio again. 4:41 remaining, 76-39. Mountaineers leading big in this one. Bramos thinks about the three, puts it up, and gets him to go. He's going to go to the line and see if his foot was on the line or not, whether it's going to be two or three free throws.
It just shows you a little bit of experience of Michael Bramos right there, getting the inexperience, you know, Kevin Jones to jump up in there on a little head fake, a little head pump, and jump into him for the free throws. And, you know, last night, it was really funny. I'm at practice. And, you know, talking to Bobby, I was like, you know, Bobby, do you really enjoy being back here at West Virginia? I said, Jason, you know, I love Kansas State. There are no better people. I love Cincinnati. They're great people. But there's nothing like coming home to the school I went to and getting a chance to coach in the home Jerry West built, a great bunch of kids. And that's what he has. He's a great bunch of kids. And, you know, he's like, I'll see you back at the hotel. I'm like, at the hotel? What are you talking about? He's like, well, I've been living there for a couple months until my house is built.
Must be nice. They're looking in the monitor right now to figure out if this is indeed a three-point attempt or not. That'll determine whether Bramos will shoot two or three at the free throw line. Looks like he's just behind that new white three-point line there.
It's a three. Got to give it to him. He's been working hard. I like the perseverance he's trying to show through adversity. His team's not playing that well, but the kid is not a quitter. He's going to continue to fight each and every possession.
You mentioned the house that Jerry West built where his son Johnny is on the team. Tough go for him. He's a 6'3 guard, a sophomore, and he's out indefinitely. He broke his foot in practice on the 8th of December before the big Davidson game in Madison Square Garden. First free throw by Bramos is good.
The rest of you see Joe Mazzulla next time. You gotta wonder if Joe Mazzulla is going to be able to get back after that shoulder injury. The way the doctor described it to me is it's kind of like a growth plate that's never really fused together. And he was born with this. It looks like a fracture in the MRI on his shoulder. And you know, they're treating it with ice and stem, and he's doing some water workouts, but it's still inflamed above the fracture, looks like, and below it. So, I mean, he gets back. He's the knit and grit to this team. He's the emotional leader, the guy that brings it and sets the tempo at the point guard position. And it's been a great guy for Daryl Bryant to learn underneath for a little while he's here.
Alex Ruoff checks out of the game. Looks like his day might be done. In comes Josh Sowards, the walk-on from Fort Union Milwaukee Academy. He's a West Virginia native from Scott Depot as Butler knocks down another three. 23 points for him. Another field goal, and he will break his career high.
Well, Josh Sauer was getting a lot of mess yesterday from Bobby Huggins. They were joking with him on the free throw line, saying that he's a 50% free throw shooter. And I was asking the guys, you know, like, he's our best shooter on the team. The problem is he's only taking two free throws. And Bobby was like, well, listen, I shot 81% of my career.
Butler is feeling it.
1,000-point score.
26 points on the night. That's a new career high, breaking his mark of 24 that he put up against Davidson.
He needs one more point for 1,000.
With how well he's shooting, you gotta believe they're gonna keep feeding him the rock. Soderberg dribbles too far on the baseline, goes out of bounds. Has some more subs coming in. And Deshaun Butler from beyond the arc in the second half, heating up. Closing. Little more than 3 minutes to play in Morgantown, West Virginia. The Mountaineers 82, Miami, Ohio 41. And that last trip down the court put Deshaun Butler over the 1,000-point mark for his career. Into the last timeout, given a standing ovation from the blue and gold faithful, Jay. And just a junior out of New Jersey who has just done it all for this team in his time in a Mountaineer uniform.
Well, we said at the beginning of the game, Bobby Huggins wants Deshaun Butler to be aggressive. Now, his last game against Davidson, he took 21 shots. That's the most aggressive I've seen him. Now today, 11 for 17, really coming out of the gate and just showing you why he's the best player on the West Virginia roster.
Few walk-ons onto the floor for both teams as Winbush puts up the three too long. Dee Proby is a junior college transfer for the Mountaineers, and Josh Sowers, the three-point attempt. He's a walk-on for West Virginia.
Surprised that Josh Sowers didn't make that. He was acting as Michael Bramos yesterday. He was making everything in practice.
Nice little up and under by Winbush. 8 points on the game.
I like Winbush. 6'7", his 215 frame, can shoot the ball lefty, can throw you off, but also can attack the rim. Has a high basketball IQ and understanding of plays and where to be at the right time.
Another freshman into the game as Sowers takes another three, no good. The other freshman with the rebound and the ball right now, number 33, Cam Payne. He's a redshirt freshman, a West Virginia native out of Charleston. Three rims in and out for Kevin Jones. Rodney Haddock's back the other way. Miami played in the CBI Invitational last year, postseason play after the MAC tournament. Shot up, looked like it was blocked, but Winbush will go to the line to shoot two.
West Virginia foul call.
Haddock's a guy who only played in four games last year, but after the MAC tournament, Miami, Ohio went to the CBI, and Haddock's had 12 points in that game against Tulsa to lead the team. Miami, Ohio lost that first round game. First free throw good by Winbush. Trying to get back to the NCAA tournament where they were 2 years ago and came within 2 points of knocking off the 3 seed Oregon. The Redhawks were a 14 seed in that game. That was after a 3-point buzzer beater in the MAC championship final by Doug Penno to send them to the big dance.
But you gotta think it's a matter of time before Coach Cole gets that signature win. They've been so close, they almost had it against UCLA. They almost had it against Pitt, I mean, even though they lost by around 16, but they were in the game. They almost had it against Xavier, only losing by 7. They got a big win against Temple, but it's just a matter of time before Kenny Hayes gets healthy and him and Bramos are a dynamic duo together.
Into the lane, and there is a foul on the play.
West Virginia foul called at number 45, Dee Proby.
They're gonna get Proby for it. Winbush will go to the line to shoot two more. And you look at the schedule coming up for these two teams. Miami, Ohio is playing West Virginia today, and on the 6th, another big non-conference game against their Ohio rival, so to speak, in Dayton out of the A-10. It's really the biggest non-conference game of the year they have left on their schedule. And second free throw, no good. Miami, Ohio, and head coach Charlie Cole's not afraid to schedule big non-conference games. You look at the schedule this year at UCLA, at Pitt, at Xavier. All losses, but you saw what a team like Davidson did last year when you play that top talent. Maybe not beating them, but it helps you when you get later into the season in your mid-major schedule. Under a minute to play here in the game. Coming up at 2 o'clock, the top-ranked North Carolina Tar Heels take on Valparaiso in the United Center in Chicago. Stay tuned for that. 82-44, three-point field goal, no good. Goes begging by Soderberg. And just an all-around great effort on both ends of the court for West Virginia today.
Get to check out Psycho T. This team coming in company, going against Valpo. All-time leading scorer for UNC history over the greats of Phil Ford, Michael Jordan, Sam Perkins. It's a good company to be involved in, isn't it?
Absolutely. 5-second differential, 3-point field goal, no good. And see if Miami, Ohio takes a final shot with 10 seconds to play.
Well, great game played by West Virginia. Came out, really established the tempo early, and they led by example. Deshaun Butler being a guy with 28 points. Took over the leadership role for this team.
The basket goes off from the Mountaineer. Campaign dribbles it out, and West Virginia, after a 7-day break for finals, comes back home to the WVU Coliseum and takes care of the Miami, Ohio Redhawks 82-46. Head coach Bob Huggins ties Norm Sloan, NC State's late great head coach for 28th all time. Again, final score 82-46 here in the WVU Coliseum. We'll take a break and come back, put a wraps on this one here in Morgan.